Good afternoon, dear students. I welcome you all for the second lecture of Animal Systematics and Diversity.
Good afternoon, dear students.
In last lecture,
I welcome you all for the second lecture of Animal Systematics and Diversity.
Now, in this last lecture, we are going to study the general characteristics,
actual unit of phylum Globosa.
Now, in this second lecture,
today we are going to study
2 points. The
first is the unit
and study of
phylum Globosa,
which is commonly known as apple points.
First is the systematic study of phylum Globosa,
but which is commonly known as apple snail.
Second topic that we are going to study is the
not only systematic study of the
but with apple snail or phylum Globosa.
Second topic that we are going to study is the
second habitat or habitat of
study of phylum Globosa
or phylum
Globosa. So let's start with our second lecture on study of phylum Globosa, systematic position.
So hello students, today we will start with our second lecture on animal systematics and diversity. So we have started with unit number 1 in last lecture, where we have studied the general characteristics of phylum Mollusca. In today's lecture, we will be studying the systematic position of phylum Globosa with regions and habit and habitat of the phylum Globosa or apple snail. So after completing today's lecture, you should be able to understand the systematic position of phylum Globosa with regions. You should understand distribution of phylum Globosa, that means where it is present all over the world, and habit and habitat of the phylum Globosa. So now we will see the reasons for this type of classification of phylum Globosa. So first, that is phylum Mollusca. So now why it is included in the phylum Mollusca? So what are the reasons for including this animal into the phylum Mollusca? First of all, it shows soft body, so it is a soft bodied animal. Body is unsegmented and it is protected by a calcareous shell, which is secreted by the mantle. So in previous lecture, we have seen that all those animals which are soft bodied, which are unsegmented and which have the protected calcareous shell, they must be included in the phylum Mollusca. So that's why Phyla is included in the phylum Mollusca. Also, it shows some other features like ventral body wall is modified into a muscular foot. It is, and this muscular foot is normally used for creeping, burrowing, swimming. The buccal cavity is the region just beside the mouth, which contains the rasping organ, which is known as radula. Now, what is the use of this radula? It is a tongue-like structure and it bears the rows of chitinous teeth. So this rasping organ in Mollusca is a flexible tongue-like structure, or it is a tongue-like organ which has many rows of teeth on its surface, and the function of this is nothing but the cutting of the food. Okay, so remember, this rasping organ has rows of teeth and it is useful for cutting the food. Now it is included in the class Gastropoda. So why it is included in class Gastropoda? So the question should come in mind, why it is included in gastropods? So first of all, we should understand the literal meaning of the word gastropod. So gastropod is a Greek word in which gaster means stomach and podos means foot. So those animals from which the foot arises from the stomach, such animals are included in the class Gastropoda. Now, second feature, body is asymmetrical, typically with a univalve having single valve and spirally coiled shell. So if you see the shell, it is spirally coiled. So we are going to study this structure of shell in the next lecture. That time we will get more details of it. Now, the head is very distinct and it bears tentacles. So if you see, there are two pairs of tentacles. It has eyes situated on these tentacles and it has a well-defined mouth. Now the body of this mollusk undergoes torsion or detorsion and coiling. So you must have studied this in your class SYBSC, that torsion is nothing but the twisting of the internal visceral organs, which takes place in the anti-clockwise direction at an angle of 180 degrees with respect to the rest of the body. And this normally takes place in the larval development. This phenomena of torsion takes place in the free swimming stages like Weyliger larva of gastropods, and it converts the symmetrical larva into the asymmetrical adult. So this is required in the development of these animals. So the torsion takes place in the larval development, and this detorsion is exactly opposite to the torsion, which means reversion to the changes that have occurred during the torsion. So whatever changes that have happened during the torsion, they are reverted back. It is called as a detorsion. Now they have a large ventral foot. So we have studied general character that they have a large ventral foot, and it form the creeping sole, bearing and operculum. Now this operculum is like a lid to this shell. So we'll study this in the next lecture. When we study external characters, we will study the structure of operculum in minute details. Okay, now we have classified them in the subclass prosobranchia. Why we have classified them into this? Because prosobranch, this word literally means gills are present in front of the heart. Okay, so these animals always have their gills, which are nothing but respiratory structures which are present in the front of the heart. So all such animals are called as prosobranchs. So not only gills but mantle cavity as well as anus is situated in front of the heart. That's why we are classifying them into prosobranchiates. Another characteristic for their inclusion is head bears pair of tentacles. That means there are two pairs of tentacles. So you can see this is the first pair, this is the second pair, and a pair of eyes. So they have one pair of eyes and two pair of tentacles. The visceral torsion. So we have studied in this last slide, the torsion undergoes at a degree of 180 degrees, and due to this torsion, now the visceral mass and visceral nerve commissures are twisted into figure of 8. Now this visceral mass is all the organs and body parts that are present inside this shell. That is known as visceral mass. And along with this is the part of nervous system, that is visceral nerve commissures. These are twisted together to form a 8 like a figure structure. So we will be studying the visceral mass in detail again in next lecture. Mental cavity opens anteriorly and tenedium is in front of heart. So tenedium or nothing but the gill which is present in front of heart, and mental cavity always opens anteriorly. Last character to inclusion in the subclass prosobranchia is the sexes are separate. So you have a separate male and female pila globosa. Okay. Next, they are classified into the order mesogastropoda. So why or what are the reasons that we are classifying them into order mesogastropoda is, first of all, they are prosobranchs where gill is present in front of heart, and it usually has siphon, penis and non-calcified operculum. Now the radula, we have seen what is radula. So radula is nothing but a anatomical structure used by the mollusk for the feeding purpose. So it is nothing but, which it can be compared with a tongue. It has small tooth or chitinous structures present on its surface, and which are used for the cutting food before the food enters into the esophagus. Okay, so that is the function of radula, and that radula is tenioglossate type. Okay, so what is mean by that? We'll see. Means having 7 teeth like structure. So out of these 7 teeth like structures, one of the teeth like structure is present at the center, and the remaining 3 tooth are present on the either side in the submedian position. So such type of a radula is known as a tenioglossate type of radula. Next, they show presence of one monopectinate gill. Now what is mean by a monopectinate gill? So tenidium or gill is basically a respiratory organ found in the mollusk. Some aquatic gastropod possess one tenidium, they are known as monopectinate, and some have two tenidia or gills, they are called as bipectinate. So in phyla they are always monopectinate gill, that is having the one gill. Next, heart is with one auricle. It shows presence of single osphradium and single nephridium. Okay, so these are the features of the order Mesogastropoda. Then nervous system is concentrated without pedal cords. So this osphradium, first we'll understand what it means by osphradium. So this osphradium is an sense organ. So it is a olfactory organ in certain mollusks, and it is linked with a respiratory organ. Main function of this osphradium is that it tastes the incoming water for presence of any silt or sand particles and possible food particles. Okay, so it is like a siphoning structure. So you can so this organ basically functions to gather the food particles from its aquatic environment. Now the nervous system without pedal cords. So these pedal nerve cords are often lead to form the pedal ganglion in the nervous system, and this pedal word means to the foot. So these pedal cords, they are attached normally to the foot, but here such pedal cords are absent. Now next, they belong to family Pilidae because they show the presence of two pair of tentacles but one pair of labial palps. Okay, so we should understand what is mean by these labial palps. So these are the structures which are present near the mouth, and they secrete a mucus like secretion. And what is the purpose of this mucus like secretion? It entangles food particles or other nutrient particles within the water to produce a ball of food, and along with this mucus it is called as a bolus. Okay, and then it can be used as a food. Okay, so remember, these labial palps present near the mouth help in the gathering the suspended food particles in the aquatic environment. The left nasal lobe is modified into siphon. Now what is the function of siphon? It is like a sieving structure. So all the unwanted things should be removed from the aquatic environment, and only the food particles should be taken inside the body. And these are freshwater amphibious animals. So you will always find phyla, or rather mostly you will find them in the freshwater. Very few times you can also see them in the brackish water. That means slight salinity is there in that water. That is called as brackish water. And they are amphibious animals. What do you mean by amphibious? That some of the part of their life they will spend in the aquatic environment, and for some time you can see them onto the ground or the terrestrial habitat. So these are the reason that we include them in the family Pilidae. And finally, genus Phyla, species is Globosa. So there are several species of this genus Phyla, such as Phyla globosa, we commonly called as Indian apple snail, and there are even other species like Phyla virens, Phyla naviliana and Phyla olea. Now we move on to the next part of our discussion, distribution of the phyla or apple snail. So Phyla globosa is the common species of northern India. So it is mostly seen in the northern part of India, which was formerly called Ampullaria globosa. So the previous name of Phyla globosa was Ampullaria globosa, and it was later replaced by this newer name, that is Phyla globosa. There are few species which are distributed in India, like P. Phyla virens, Phyla Thorvaldi, and Phyla neveliana, which are found in the southern India. But the study animal, that is Phyla globosa, you will find only in the northern India. So we call it as apple snail. So why we call it as apple snail, we'll see. First of all, we see that Phyla has wide distribution. It is found in the two geographical regions, that is Oriental and Ethiopian regions. So these are the biogeographical regions. The Oriental region or realm includes India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, Vietnam and Philippines. So all the countries of Indian subcontinent. And the Ethiopian realm comprises of Africa, Arabia and Madagascar. So in all these areas you will find the distribution of Phyla globosa. Okay. So now we move on to the last part of our discussion. What are the habits and habitat of Phyla globosa or apple snail? First of all, we'll understand why we call it as apple snail. So this is the largest freshwater mollusk, commonly known as apple snail. The primary reason is they feed onto the apples. So this is one reason. Second reason is they grow up to the size of apple. So that can be the considered as a second reason for it is called as an apple snail. Name okay, so we find them in freshwater habitats like ponds, pools, tanks, lakes, marshes, and also we can find them in the rice fields or paddy fields. Sometimes they also occur in the river streams and brackish water areas. So I have told you, brackish water areas means where you have the fresh water meeting with the salt water. But in brackish water also, only those areas where you have low salinity, only there you can find Phyla globosa. In high salinity water, you can't find the Phyla globosa. Okay, now we move on to, after looking at their habitat, we move on to their habits. So in terms of their nutrition, feeding, they are herbivorous in nature. They prefer to clean waters with vegetation like Vallisneria. They prefer clean waters with vegetation like Vallisneria and Pistia, which form the principal food of the apple snail. Sometimes they can even also feed onto the dead animal bodies. So if these plants are not available, even they can switch their diet onto the other dead animals as carnivores. So principally they are herbivorous, but they can switch on to the carnivorous diet if food is unavailable. Now they are amphibious animals. So what is meant by amphibious animal? They are adapted to both water life, that is aquatic life, as well as terrestrial life. Next, they show presence of gills for aquatic respiration and lungs for breathing in air. Okay, so due to this modification, they can live on the land as well as in the aquatic water bodies. They can live comfortably in stagnant and oxygen poor waters. Why? Because they have the presence of both gills as well as the lungs. So due to this modification, they can live even if the oxygen of that particular water is low. We'll see remaining habits of Pylagnosa. It creeps very slowly. So being a snail, you must have seen how slowly they move. So they are very slow in their locomotion, and that locomotion takes place with a massive ventral foot. So due to this slow movement, we can also refer to as snail speed. So they hardly cover a distance of 50 millimeter in a minute at the fastest or full speed. They show gliding movement. You must have seen a snail moving. So they show movement like gliding movement, like planarians. And you must have observed that once a snail moves from particular area, you can easily make out, because they make a slime trail. Okay. To facilitate their movement, the foot produces a slime from the sole. So what is the purpose of this slime? It basically aids in the movement on a like hard or dry surfaces. So even they can move on hard and dry surfaces with the help of this slime. Okay, now they can swim with the help of lashing movements of the snout present near the mouth and tentacles in the water. So with the help of snout and two pair of tentacles, they can easily swim in water. Also, they can float on water surface whenever required. So not only they can walk, they can swim as well as they can float in the water. Also, they can climb on aquatic vegetation. So these are their locomotory characteristics, we can say. Now during rainy season, they go for the long journeys on land in search of food and water, because the abundance of food is available on the land during this time. So they can move to the land for the rainy season. And when they are disturbed, you must have seen a shell. They go inside the shell and close that shell with a lead-like structure. That lead-like structure is called as operculum. In summer season, they go into a sleep or inactivity period that is known as a summer sleep or estivation. This is also referred to as a state of latent life or dormant stage during dry season. So that because they cannot survive in very harsh dry conditions, so they go into this estivation or the summer sleep. Now during this time, they switch to the anaerobic respiration instead of aerobic respiration so as to conserve the energy. So they will bury themselves in the soil during this summer sleep. Okay, that is, burying themselves in soil is in the summer season is nothing but the estivation. And after some time, when the condition become more favorable, they will again emerge from their sleep and come to the ground again, and they can start their normal activities. So now in monsoon season, they become more active because this is the period of feeding and breeding. So all the energy required for the remaining season, they have to gather in this monsoon season. So they are actively feeding in the monsoon season. And in the next season, that is the winter season, they again goes into the sleep. So there are two type of sleep. One is summer sleep called estivation. Second sleep is known as hibernation, which takes place in the winter season, or which is also commonly referred to as winter sleep. So the pila remains in this hibernation or winter sleep unless and until the next favorable conditions come up with the presence of abundance of water and abundance of food, until that time they will remain into that hibernation or the winter sleep. Now their digestion is dual, that is, it is partially intracellular and it is partially extracellular. Okay, so we are going to study the digestive system in detail again. Sexes are separate, so you have a separate male and female pila, and breeding takes place in the rainy season. Okay, so always rainy season is the time of their breeding activity, and the fertilization is always internal. Okay, so with this we conclude today's second lecture on study of Pila globosa, that is apple snail. We have studied the systematic position with reasons, as well as we studied the habit and habitat of the Pila globosa. So I hope you have understood. If you have any questions, we are going to discuss it on a Google Meet. Thank you very much for your patience hearing.